Beloved friends, brothers and sisters in Christ, this is Brother Frank speaking to you from the Mission Center in Krefeld, Germany. I trust that the Lord has blessed you with spiritual blessings, which are all prepared through Calvary and were given to us by the grace of God. We have full redemption, forgiveness of our sins. We are reconciled with God to stop walking our own ways, to stop having our own thoughts, to stop having our own programs, but to be born again and be united with Christ, who is the head of the church. And beloved, we call it the Apostolic Prophetic Bible Teaching Ministry, knowing that whatever someone believes is very precious to you. I know this. I know that every religion, every church, every denomination, in fact, every individual is proud to believe what you believe. And beloved, to be honest, I was proud to be a Lutheran. I was proud to be a Baptist. I was proud to be a Pentecostal. Always proud. And beloved, if you go to the religions of the world, and I'm a missionary for over 40 years, have been on all continents, visiting more than 130 countries in the past 40 years. And beloved, how well do I know the value people add and give to what they believe. Whether it's right or wrong, they believe and think it's right anyway. But to us, and I say this in the plural, to us, I include you, beloved friends, who believe as the scripture says. And today, if you go into the religious world, including the charismatic movements all over the earth, you can just switch on your internet and look into it, and you find thousands upon thousands of men and women and their addresses, and everybody presents their program. One thing they all have in common, as it states here, the church or ministry must be Trinitarian and charismatic in doctrine, in practice. But I'm not Trinitarian. I'm not oneness. I have to say that by the grace of God, I was called to the ministry by an audible voice of the Lord, which went through all my bones, if I may use that term, having heard his voice with these ears on April the 2nd, 1962, just at the dawning of a new day. And the Lord said, "My servant, your time for this city will soon be over. I will send you to other cities to preach my word." The voice came from up, but from the right like this, and I fell over on the left arm, on my face, to the carpet. Beloved, I lie not. And because I was acquainted with the ministry of God's servant and prophet, William Branham, on December the 3rd, 1962, he confirmed by divine revelation, word for word, what the Lord had spoken to me over in Germany on April the 2nd, and told me what the future holds, and I should wait until the time would come. Beloved, the time has come, and since 1964, I'm traveling the countries of the world, and since 1966, I proclaim the end time message, which includes all the promises God made in His Word. And beloved, I came to know that after World War II, God used William Branham, a man sent from God, who had a unique ministry. God confirmed His Word, as in Bible days, I'm a witness, an eyewitness, ear witness of what God did in my time. Beloved, but he was told, as John the Baptist forerun the first coming of Christ, the message given to him from the Word of God would forerun the second coming of Christ. That includes the promise of Malachi chapter 4, that God would send the prophet Elijah before the great and dreadful day of the Lord comes. Beloved, our Lord confirmed this in Matthew 17, verse 11, and also in Mark chapter 9, verse 12. Truly, Elijah shall first come and restore all things. Beloved, before the return of Jesus Christ, all things must be restored to where they were at the very beginning. In apostolic Bible days, that includes the teaching about the Godhead, about water baptism, about the baptism of the Holy Spirit, about the Lord's Supper. It includes every Bible teaching which must be restored, and also all the power of God must return to the Church of the Living God in the restoration itself. And therefore, William Branham preached truthfully God's holy word, that God is one. Throughout all the Old Testament, we know Him as the only one true God who revealed Himself to Abraham, to Moses, to the children of Israel. The great I Am, the Elohim of the Old Testament, became our Father in the New Testament, and Yahweh of the Old Testament, which was God's personal, visible manifestation, the great I Am, was not a second person. He was the invisible God who is spirit, manifested in a visible form of appearance. The Lord God, this term you find over 6,000 times in the Old Testament. Not one time you find recorded that a father spoke to a son. Not one time you find recorded that Abraham or Moses or one of the prophets spoke to a father in heaven, leave alone to a son in heaven. Throughout the period of the 4,000 years of the Old Testament, but you find all the promises given throughout that period about the Messiah, about the Son of God to come to be born on earth to redeem us, so we would be placed back into the sonship to be sons and daughters of God again. So in the Old Testament, we have all the promises about redemption. And in the New Testament, we have the fulfillment thereof. Beloved, it is very, very important. In fact, it is a must to come out from all confusion, from all Babylonian teachings, which started in the 3rd century when the Roman Church was formed. And beloved, let me say this in love, but very straight. We don't go back to Tertullian, not to Athanasius, not to Augustine, not to Hieronymus. We don't go back to anyone of the so-called church fathers. We go back to the apostles and prophets. We go back to the New Testament. We go back to the Old Testament. We take the 4 Gospels and what the Lord commissioned, and we go to the book of Acts to see how they understood, how they practiced what the Lord had said. Beloved, it's absolutely necessary to know the difference between right and wrong. Today, everybody calls his teaching biblical. You go to the Church of Rome, to the Orthodox Church, to the Lutheran Church, to the Calvinistic Church, and everybody says, we're Bible-believing Christians. We believe the Bible. To a certain extent, it might be true, because every church takes a certain portion from God's Word and then twists it in every direction. And to be honest, every church puts the Word of God into its own direction. But now the time has come to move in God's direction. If we go to Bible prophecies, then we have to understand that God watches over his word to fulfill it, especially about Israel, about the things which are now taking place among the nations, the coming up of the old Roman Empire, which will come to world rule, world government, global control of all things. Beloved, it's not only the end time, it's the end of the end time. And we have to say, as it is written in Matthew 25, behold, the bridegroom cometh. Go ye out to meet him. Be prepared as the bride church to meet the bridegroom. In reference to the Godhead, you find the Shema Israel, that which was given from the lips of the Almighty to Moses, and he in turn spoke it to the children of Israel. God saying, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4 and 5. You can go through all the Old and the New Testament. Never do you find that God spoke of himself as existing in 3 individual persons, 3 eternal, 3 almighty. Such a word does not exist in the Bible. The term triune God, the term Trinity, do not exist in God's vocabulary. Beloved, the time has come, and I say again, I'm not against any church or any denomination, but as a true servant of God, I must preach the true word of God. Let God be true and every man be a liar. And we say, like Paul was writing to the Romans, asking, what does the scripture say? Not what does Athanasius say? Not what does Tertullian say? But what did Peter say? What did James say? What did John say? What did Apostle Paul say? Return to God and His Word. Beloved, even if we come to what happens with Israel, the Holy Scripture very plainly says in Isaiah chapter 14, verse 1, that God would gather them again and bring them into their own land. And you go again to Jeremiah chapter 31, from 1 to 10, he that scattered Israel will gather him and bring him back again. You can go to Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 24, where it says, I will gather you from all the nations whereunto I scattered you, and bring you back into your own land. And then we have the word of God for the end time about those who are now trying to divide the land of Israel, which God calls Himself my land. It was promised to Abraham and was given to the 12 tribes when the time of fulfillment came. Joel chapter 3, verse 2, I will also gather you from all nations and will bring them down into the valley of Jehoshaphat, and will judge them for my people and for my heritage, Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations. And now comes the very important part in verse 2, the last words, and parted my land. Right now, they are parting the land of Israel, which God calls His own land. Looking onto the map, one has to recognize that the Arabic nations surrounding Israel are 640 times larger than the small country of Israel. And beloved, as a German citizen, I can say after World War II, we had 13 million refugees from the Eastern territories, and they all had to be placed in the Western territories because they were refugees. We did not put them into camps. They were integrated into society. How well could have all those who are now calling themselves Palestinian refugees could have been integrated into all the neighboring countries already since 1948? Beloved, let's look at these things as they are. Finally, the peace process will be on the agenda, not only one of many subjects, but will remain the last and most important subject, because the scripture says in the prophet Daniel, chapter 8, verse 25, he will destroy many by peace. And if you go to 2 Thessalonians, chapter 2, there the scripture speaks about the coming of the Lord and about the man of sin. And then if you go back to 1 Thessalonians, chapter 5, 1 to 3, we are told when they will say peace and safety, then sudden destruction will come upon them. And if you go to Matthew 24, to Mark 13, to Luke 21, we are told about the return of the Jews to the promised land in the symbol of the fig tree. And when that takes place, our Lord said, this generation shall not pass till all things be fulfilled. And He also makes the statement, when you see all these things come to pass, look up, for your redemption is drawing near. Beloved, I don't see anything about any religion against any church. I'm not entitled to do that, but because of a divine commission, I must tell you that heaven and earth will pass away. All explanations, all interpretations of the Word of God will pass away. Only the Word of God remains forever. And if you wish to remain forever, then the Word of God must be in you, for the Word is the seed. So we partake of the divine nature, because the Word of God is divine, and we receive the Word of God as a divine seed into our heart. No explanations are added. And if you go again to Matthew 13, you find there were two sowers. The Son of Man was sowing the good seed, and the good seed was the Word of God. And the good seed sprang up in the kingdom of God, and that were the children of God. You can read it, chapter 13 in Matthew, verse 37 and 38. Those children of the kingdom of God are born again because the seed of God's word was placed in them, and the Holy Spirit came upon them, so their new life was born in them. Beloved, this is very essential for each and every one of us. God did not bring us a new religion. God brought us new life. He said, I will make a new covenant. I will give you a new heart, a new life, a new spirit. And beloved, I have to say it again. Before the return of Christ, which is imminent, there must be a preparation, a calling out of the bride church from all confusion to be sanctified in the Word of God. John 17, 17, our Lord prayed, sanctify them in the truth. Thy word is the truth. Every interpretation is a lie. And if you go back to Matthew 13, the good sower was the Son of Man sowing the good seed. But then when people slept, the enemy came and sowed his own seed. On the same soil that the first seed was sown, and the Lord said, let it grow until the harvest. And every seed brings forth after its own kind. Beloved, what type of seed are you? Are you the original word seed, or are you the seed of interpretations? You might be in the same kingdom of God, on the same field, and the same spiritual rain might come upon you. The same Son of Righteousness might be upon you as well. But what type of seed are you? Every seed brings forth after its own kind. Beloved, I have to emphasize that God used William Branham after World War II to bring about the breakthrough of this last healing revival. But here is the point. He was the one to restore us back to the beginning. What about all the other evangelists who also came on the scene? Did they understand the purpose of that ministry? I, by God's grace, understood this divine purpose. Whatever God does is connected to a purpose. And God fulfills His word and brings us back to the beginning right now. Receive it and pray, and may the will of God and the Word of God be revealed to you. I, Brother Frank, greet you especially from the Mission Center in Krefeld, Germany. Wherever you are, receive Christ, receive His Word, and may divine revelation be granted to you, and may you be part of the bride church, which is preparing to meet the bridegroom. Behold, the bridegroom cometh. Go ye out to meet him. God bless you and be with you in Jesus' holy name. Amen.